Hi, this is Abhilash Majumdar, a research scientist from Morgan Stanley. Previously, I was working for HSBC as a deep learning NLP engineer. I have also collaborated with Google Research in matters of BERT and Albert models and other language models. I have mentored students and professionals for organizations like Udemy, Udacity, and UpGrad in terms of NLP, AI, deep learning. So I have quite some exposure in mentoring. And today we're going to talk about encoder decoder models. So if you, and also welcome to Co-Learning Lounge YouTube channel. So in this channel, we will be posting regular updates on different complex topics of NLP, like attention, BERT, and state of the art language models. Along with this, if you want to connect with me, you can find the details in the description in the link given below. Also feel free to comment and also subscribe to this channel. And let's get started with the encoder decoder architecture. So we had covered till LSTMs, GRUs in the last video. So building on top of it, we will be moving towards the encoder decoder model, which is nothing but a sophisticated neural architecture comprising of different stacks of LSTMs, different variants of LSTMs and GRUs. So in this case, we'll be seeing what are the use cases of these encoder decoder models. Since the invention of sequence-to-sequence model by Ilya, so from OpenAI, the details of neural machine translation and also the important features of text classification, question answering, semantic inference, all these kinds of NLP tasks have gained massive popularity because of this sequence-to-sequence model. It gradually, in the context of neural machine translation, this has achieved a great performance where we want to map certain words from a different language to another different language. In the example given over here, how are you is in English and ni hao ma is in Chinese. So this is achieved with the help of sequence-to-sequence model. And we are going to study a variant of the sequence-to-sequence model that is known as the encoder-decoder architecture. In the 2016 paper from Google, which was named as the Jointly Aligning to Translate, by Bahadanu, it was one of the most important papers which gave birth to this idea of encoder decoders along with a concept called as attention, which we will cover later in our video tutorials. Now, coming ourselves to the basic architecture of encoder decoders, these are nothing but stacks of certain recurrent neural networks which are coupled on back of each other like a stack. So when we move forward to a general sequence-to-sequence model, it is generally refers to mapping certain parts of a vocabulary to certain parts of a vocabulary. So this model aims to map a fixed length input with a fixed length output, where the length of the input and the output may differ. So basically, in the case of language models where machine translation is very much required, different languages in different may have different lengths of the sentences when they are translated. Such as what are you doing today in English, the Chinese version of this particular sentence or this particular question has only 5 words and an output of 7 symbols. So clearly this general LSTM or GRU architectures do not sufficiently fail, they actually fail to actually scale or try to reproduce these kinds of results. Because LSTM networks tries to map each word to each word, so they will tend to have an equal sized input and an equal sized output for mapping each of the input words to the output words. But what will happen if we want to, classify different sizes of inputs and different sizes of outputs, which is the case of neural machine translation. So in this case, English to Chinese translation is not achievable with just a plain or a vanilla LSTM network or a vanilla GRU network or any versions of RNNs. So we consider ourselves with a encoder decoder model, and this is the diagram of a standard encoder decoder model where we have stacks of RNN cells. These RNN cells can be LSTM cells, this can be GRU cells as well. So in basic sense, these are generally comprised of bidirectional LSTM cells or bidirectional GRU cells. So generally we have the X as the input features and we have the hidden state from the previous time step of the previous cell. So these can be any variants of RNN, just like I mentioned, either LSTM or GRUs. If we are considering LSTM, then each of the intermediate hidden layers, each of the intermediate hidden cells will have two outputs. That is the H and the C. That is the hidden cell state and the current cell state, H and C. But if we were using GRUs, then as we know, in GRUs, the two hidden states, that is H and C, are merged together. So we will have a single hidden state that is known as H. So depending upon the architectures or the internal neural network structures that we use, LSTMs will have intermediate two outputs, whereas the GRUs will have intermediate one outputs. So in this stack of LSTM cells or GRU cells, the input gets passed one after the other for each particular LSTM cell. This is denoted by X1, X2, and X3. Whereas the output of the hidden cell is also transmitted one after the other, one cell after the other for each timestamp. This is denoted by H1, H2, and H3. And in the intermediate part of this LSTM stack of cells, these are returned as sequences rather than distinct outputs. This part comprises the encoder model. And this is particularly adhering to one language, let's say English. What happens after this is the last LSTM cell or the last RNN cell, it outputs certain values. Traditionally, an LSTM outputs three values. So we have the hidden cell state, we have the cell state, that is C, and we have the output value. And if we were to comprise ourselves of this particular part, then one thing we can do is that the most important thing that we can do is that whenever we consider ourselves the output of the last LSTM cell, we can try to earth it. That means we will not consider the output that is coming out from the last LSTM cell from the encoder. We will just consider ourselves with the hidden outputs, that is the H and the C, if we're considering LSTM. Now, similarly, if we're considering GRUs for our use case, then there will be a single combined hidden state, that is H, and an corresponding output. So for a GRU, there are only two outputs, output state O and a combined hidden state, that is H. So similarly, the output of the encoded GRU will not be taken into consideration, and only the hidden state, that is the H state, will be taken into consideration for the decoder input. Now, this particular thing is known as the encoder vector. That is the hidden cell output of the stack of LSTM cells, encoded cells, is known as the encoder vector. This is passed onto the decoder as the input. So the decoder is a similar architecture. It comprises of the same version of RNNs, right? Or it can be variants of LSTM, or it can be variants of GRUs as well. So similarly, we pass the encoder vector, which is the output of the LSTM encoders, right? And we also pass, there will be another inputs, which is corresponding to the inputs of the different language, that is Chinese in our case. So the inputs of the Chinese language and the encoded vector hidden cell together, that is the output of the encoded cell together, forms the input of the decoders. And in decoders, we have a similar architecture where we pass the hidden states for each of the individual LSTM or the GRU units or any RNN variant units of the decoder model. So if we were to move in a descriptive part, so what will to happen? So the model consists of three parts, that is the encoder, the intermediate encoder vector, that is the output of the encoder cell and the input to the decoder cell, and the decoder. So the encoder consists of a stack of recurrent units, that is LSTM, GRU, or any time distributed recurrent neural networks. So where these types accept a single element of input, collects information for that particular element and propagates through that network, through that stack of cells. And then if we have a question answering problem, the input sequence is a collection of all the words from that particular question. Now, generally, if you want to do translation or if you want to do question answering or any kind of NLP task, there are tokens which are getting appended. Tokens means that there's a start token and there is a stop token. The start token signifies that the start is this marks as the starting of the sentence in a particular language. The stop token signifies that this is a stop symbol or this is the terminal part of that particular language. So this is very important because when we are considering ourselves with neural machine translation, we know that different sized inputs will have different sized outputs. So it is very important to have a start symbol and a stop symbol or tokens to which specifies the LSTM cell, which specifies the encoder as well as the decoder, where to stop our, you know, training purposes, where to stop, where the input stops. So this is very, very important. And when we consider ourselves with the internal hidden layers in a particular stack of LSTMs for the encoder or the decoder, we know that inside a particular LSTM, we have the TANH activation and we have a similar kind of a function that saw previously, that we have WHH into HT minus one plus WXH into XT. The input, this is the corresponding weight vector for the input. HT minus one is the previous timestamp hidden cell and WHH is its corresponding weight. And F is generally TANH. If we have seen the previous videos, LSTM, we generally use the TANH version. And we get the hidden output. Now, This is all good when it is when we're considering ourselves with the intermediate parts. That means inside these intermediate cells, which returns a sequence rather than an output. Now, if you want to generate the output, we generally want to do a softmax of this HT with corresponding to its corresponding weight. Now, encoder vector, this is the final hidden state that is produced from the encoder part of the model. As it is calculated using that formula above, where we only pass the hidden state. We do not consider ourselves with the output of the LSTM cells. Now, this also forms as the input to the decoder part. Now, what is the decoder? The decoder is a stack of several recurrent units similar to LSTM or similar to a GRU. Now, if you're using the same version, if you're using the LSTM version with the LSTM version, that is LSTM, LSTM encoder, decoder, it is known as a homologous encoder decoder model because the architecture almost remains the same. But if you were to use a variant, let's say a bidirectional LSTM and a single LSTM version stacks in the decoder part, then it will be a hybrid version. Because in the encoder part, we are using bidirectionality, well as in the decoder part, we are just using normal stack of LSTM cells. A stack of several recurrent units where each predicts an output YT at a time step T. So this can be for the different languages, right? When we are converting from English to a particular word to a Chinese word or a different language word. So each recurrent unit accepts a hidden state that is from the previous unit, as we saw before, because there are stacks of recurrent units. So these accepts the hidden states over here, and they also accept the encoder vector from the output of the encoder cell, right? And this is computed as this particular equation that is given over here, which is nothing but WHH into HT minus one. And because in general decoders, we generally do not have the XT part. We generally have only the HT minus one, that is only the input hidden layers. We generally do not have the XT. But there are other variants of this particular aspect as well, because if we are using for other tasks, let's say, text classification or sentiment classification, we want to use embeddings. We want to use an embedding layer with the input, and we also want to use some other attributes as well. So if we just consider ourselves with the embedding layer, if we want to use embeddings for our text classification through an encoder decoder model, then this equation becomes a bit more elongated to also include the embedding vector as well. So here, plus we will add, and we will also add the weights of the embedding vectors as well in our hidden states for our evaluation. So that is the only difference that is required to be done, because we are particularly seeing for the case of neural machine translation, where we are mapping a particular phrases of words or phrases to another phrases in a different language. But in the case of text classification, we have to apply some kind of embedding matrix as well, or embedding layer as well. So moving forward, the output, since the decoder also, we need the output, we also get the output by using the softmax activation of the final hidden state of the decoder model. So in the case, what is the difference between the encoder and the decoder is that in the encoder, the output we do not consider. We only consider the output hidden state, that is the H of the encoder stack of LSTM cells or GRU cells. But in the decoder, we do not consider ourselves with the output, with the final output hidden cell. We consider ourselves with the only output, that is the O. We do not consider ourselves with the H of the decoder part, because we want the output probabilities, that is the softmax output probabilities. So another analogy can be that we consider all of this, that is the encoder and the decoder, to be stacks of different LSTM or GRU units placed one after the other, where only the hidden cell or only the hidden signals get passed one after the other. And the outputs does not come into the picture. The output only comes into the picture at the last or the decoder last LSTM or GRU unit. Before that, no output comes into the picture here. Only the hidden cells or only the hidden calculations comes into the picture throughout the encoder and the decoder. So this is what the entire architecture of an encoder and a decoder looks like. So generally in a decoder, in neural machine translation, in the case of a decoder, the equation is a bit reduced as compared to the encoder, because we only consider ourselves with WHH into HT minus one. But in the case of text classification, we also have to add some embedding vector as well. We also have to add some input embedding matrices or input embedding vectors for our language, for our model to classify. And needless to say, this encoder decoder architecture forms a block of neural machine architecture. Now, if we want to build on top of it, say, let's say we want to add a feed forward neural network or a simple dense network on top of it, then that can also be done. So whatever is the output of the decoder part, we can also pass it through a dense network, and we can have any kind of activation functions like sigmoids, softmax to generate our corresponding probabilities for our text classification task. So the encoder-decoder architecture can be considered as a very sophisticated neural network architecture based on sequence-to-sequence learning, which tries to capture more and more information, which a standard LSTM cell will fail to do, or a standard vanilla LSTM architecture will fail to do. So it may be very important for neural machine translation, where we have different lengths of inputs and different lengths of outputs, as well as text classification, question answer generation by employing the use of certain start and stop tokens. And this is very important because an improvement from the standard LSTM or the vanilla architecture, because we are considering ourselves to the hidden parts or the hidden computations of each of the encoder and the decoder models. So this leads to more memory retention as well as more performance. So this was all that I had covered regarding encoders and decoders. Definitely in the next topic, we are going to cover about attentions and sophisticated details about it. So these encoder decoders have another module, which is mathematical computation tool, which is known as attention. There are different variants of it. And these attention mechanisms also help to boost the performance of translation and any other language modeling tasks, let's say classification or question answer generation, anything. So this was in general all that I had to cover, and I will see you guys in the next video tutorial. Thank you.